Over the last few months, the Defend and Extend Public Housing Group have been running monthly protests out the front of Parliament House to try and get the focus of the politicians and also members of the public on this very important issue. We certainly need more public housing, and they've certainly had quite a lot to say at each of the rallies.
Themselves into their anointed inner sanctum about what to do about public housing. They have no interest at all. Minister Foley in particular has no interest absolutely in what we have to say, what public tenants have to say, what those who are displaced and currently homeless have to say about the situation of the provision of housing for Victoria's citizens. Now, what we have been told repeatedly this year by Tim Pallas, the Treasurer, and by Martin Foley, the relevant Minister, to date, is that by the end of 2016 there will be a 10-year plan announced by the Andrews Labor Government. It is now the middle of November, and all we know is this, that they have been talking and consulting with their anointed inner sanctum, Council for Homeless Persons, Launch Housing, Brendan Noddle of the Salvation Army, and those others who have the blessing of the minister to go about their business in whatever way they choose. And I could give you a quote from a meeting that the team from Exodus by Experience had with Martin Foley some time back when he told us explicitly he does not care. He does not care how the sector goes about its business.
Now, look, I'd just like to remind you, it's all very well to stand here on the steps of Parliament House and clap. Example, we had 11 of the politicians respond to our personal invitation to come and speak to us. Obviously, only Alan Sandell from the Greens will be speaking with us in the next minute or so. But Richard Wynne, there is division within the ALP Cabinet regarding this position because the numbers men and women can count. And they know they will lose 6 to 7 seats in the inner city if they go ahead with these policies and people like us can mobilise public housing tenants. They know that. And Richard Wynne wrote wishing us, saying he couldn't come, but wishing us all the best with the rally. So I'm saying to you, the reason there hasn't been an announcement is because there is a division in Cabinet regarding this policy, especially from members who are not going to retire, and I assume Mr. Foley will retire at the end of the election and collect his superannuation, who are not going to retire, who are concerned about these seats. So this is a winnable campaign, and we can win it before Christmas. But we need you to volunteer to come to the ALP State Conference on Saturday, hand out the leaflets, interact with the delegates, tell them what's happening and tell them, do you want to commit political suicide or do you want to be re-elected at the next election? Okay, Alan Sandell, the member from Melbourne.
Thanks, Joe. Thank you, everyone. And sorry to cut into the line, but I'm not even supposed to be here. Parliament's still sitting and I'm not allowed outside the building, but I thought it was too important not to sneak out. So don't tell anybody. My name is Ellen Sandell. I'm with the Greens. I'm the member for Melbourne, which includes all the inner suburbs. I spoke at the last rally. A lot of you will know, of course, that my electorate has more public housing than any other electorate, apart from Richard Wynne's electorate. So very high amount of public housing in my electorate, and we value it, let me tell you. And right now, actually, in this place, the bill that politicians are debating is whether to create a common waiting list, so one waiting list for public housing and community housing. And I've been sitting in there listening to Labor MPs get up and talk about how they value public housing, yet not one of them has talked about plans to transfer or privatise public housing. They're not being clear with the community about their plans, and that is just not on. And what Joe says is absolutely right. What it will take to change their mind is actually the political pressure. This is the only thing that I've seen change the ALP's mind on policy in the last 2 years since I've been in this place, and it works, let me tell you. We have got incredible decisions on things like banning coal seam gas across the state, where the Labor Party were in favour of the gas industry, but the community created so much public pressure that then they came out and supported a permanent ban on the coal seam gas industry. So we know that public pressure, particularly in marginal seats like here in the inner city, absolutely works. So what you are doing is absolutely the right thing, and please keep doing it. I know that it's hard to come out week after week, but it's the only thing that it will work. And when I got up and gave my speech on this bill, I talked about the fact that there are over 35,000 families and people on that public housing waiting list. And whether it's a common waiting list with community housing or not, it makes no difference if we actually don't invest in more public housing, maintenance for the existing public housing, and stop the sell-off of public housing or the transfers. Because what use will it be if you're on a waiting list, no matter what waiting list it is, if you still can't get a house, which is the problem that 35,000 people have now, because we just simply do not invest in public housing in this state. We invest the lowest amount per capita of any state and territory, which is just outrageous.
State in Northcote and have lived there for about 38 years, successfully raising two children, both now university graduates. Unfortunately, I'm still there and now faced with demolition.
I mean, this is happening around Victoria, not just in the CBD. Every week, every day, we're getting calls from people who find themselves in the same situation. One moment, security for 38 years, the next moment, it's all set up for this private-public partnership.
Us all coming together and having a very large public sleep out here on the steps of Parliament in the next 28 days to bring attention to the public housing crisis and get the Melbourne City Council to overturn their vote from last night.
Set the date, we'll do the publicity.
A little article that I like, and I just was going to read the last paragraph. I work on a show called The Sewer Show, Squatters and Unwage Workers Airwaves, and this is a different perspective. This is 3CR. Even though our economies are built around keeping the price too high for most people, housing isn't scarce. It would be even less scarce if we took away its status as a commodity and did away with incentives to speculate and or collect rent and interest. So what I say is property is theft and long live squatting. Listen to The Sewer Show every Friday, 5:30 to 6:30.
Thank you, Margaret. Thank you. Very short and sweet. Any other hands up? Okay. Well, I'm going to thank the ladies that have spoken so far. And for all the young women around the street here that are listening, remember public housing is something that we need as infrastructure. Push for your kids and your grandchildren, because not all of them are going to be able to afford to buy a house in this country like we used to be able to. Defend and extend public housing. That's what we're about. So anything you can do, I urge you to do it. Would you like to have a speak? Yes. Come on up. Jean has been at the last three rallies. This is our fourth rally. And Jean, hats off to all of you that keep coming and keep coming and keep spreading the news. And Jean is one of them. So thank you. I'm sure you've got something to say.
Well, I like to show up. Shame on the government. Nobody asked to be homeless. And what right have they to sell off public housing? They are not voted in for that. Why are they doing it? And they don't even have the decency to come and speak to the people here. Shame on the government. And not this present government. I think the rot started with Canon. I really hate him.
Thank you, Jane. Good on you. Okay. Do we give it over to the men if there's no more women, Joe? Or? Would there be any man who would like to come up and speak on behalf of public housing? Yeah? Okay. Come on up. What's your name?
Alan Minadu.
Alan Minadu. Thank you, all the women who participated, and any men who would like to join in now feel very welcome.
Thanks very much. I'll talk a little bit louder, because I think people need to hear a little bit more. There's more problems going on than they think. I've spoken at a number of homeless rallies, and this rally is in front of the Parliament House. All of these things are connected, believe it or not. The privatisation of the council means the council believes it's a business. The council is not a business. The council is removing people from the streets because it affects business. A short lesson in the Constitution. The state government runs everything, all the assets in the state. The council is a department of the state. The same as our friends in the police force. They're a department. Think of the chaos if every police station started making its own laws. That's what we got going on here. The Council of Melbourne are making special laws and they're not a government. They're going, we're a business.
About a week later, there was another action being run at the Multicultural Hub at the top of Elizabeth Street. And this was a public forum about Melbourne City Council's plan to criminalise the homeless. And this was attended by quite a lot of people, and we struggled to get them all in the room, actually. And I was able to film this, and I hope to present some of this in upcoming episodes, as well as I'm going to feature this in the last part of my documentary that I'm about to release. But it's not just the homeless issues that are important. And only a few days after this, we actually had student representatives up at the State Library, and they were protesting against apparent plans by the federal government to further privatise tertiary education.
No cuts, no fees. Education should be free, 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 no cuts.
I reckon we'll do another bit of a classic chant. I think everyone probably knows this one if you've been to a rally before. If you haven't come to the rallies before, then excellent. You can pick it up. It goes, Turnbull, get out. We know what you're all about. Cuts, job losses, money for the bosses. Turnbull, get out. We know what you're all about.
Cuts, job losses, money for the bosses.
We know what you're all about.
Cuts.
You guys sound great, so I reckon we'll start off the rally now. This is part of a national rally, so in cities all around this country, students today are coming out onto the streets to fight for our education, to fight for our rights. All over this country, students are coming out, and we're demanding free education for every single student in this country. My name's Jasmine. I'm going to be chairing the rally today. I'm from the Environment and Social Justice Department at Monash University. And we're part of the National Union of Students, which is the national body that's organised the protest today. I reckon it's important that we start off this rally with an acknowledgement of country, because we're holding this protest today on stolen land. The land that we stand on was stolen from the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation, and it was never ceded. We acknowledge our elders past and present and any elders here today. But also, I think I can speak for all of us, we stand in solidarity with the ongoing struggle by Aboriginal people for their rights. Aboriginal land always was, always will be Aboriginal land. We're here today to stand against the Vice Chancellors who are equally committed to this agenda of further privatising universities. Vice Chancellors all over this country are bringing in attacks. They see students as dollar signs. They're bringing through restructures. At University of Sydney, they're adding a mandatory fourth year for arts students to make sure they can squeeze just a bit of extra profit out of students. Shame.
Hey.
So we're We're here today to fight against all of the attacks that the government and the Vice Chancellors are waging on us. But we're here today to fight for a lot more. We're here today to fight for free education. So I reckon just for a minute we can get that other chant back up and going that you guys practiced before. It goes no cuts, no fees. Education should be free, no cuts.
No fees. Education should be free, no cuts. Education should be free.
Well, not really. I mean, I'm poor, you know. I'm in Australia. It's possible to do it again. Higher education to fund free university for every student in Australia. Do you know how much that will cost? It will cost $8 billion.
Sorry, I'm not used to
that. Do you guys know what Gina Reinhardt's salary is? It's around $8 billion, yeah, $18 billion, oh, even more. So she could fund higher education for every single student in Australia. That's also true, yeah. Cut back. They say warfare, we say welfare. Warfare. Give yourself a round of applause.
Awesome. Come there.
Our first speaker today, she's just down there, it's going to be Matilda Gray. Matilda is the president of the student union at Monash University. Over the course of this year, she's been central to building this campaign on that campus, and she's going to speak for us now. So everyone, welcome Matilda.
Hi everyone, it's awesome to see such a great turnout, and there's heaps of students here from a lot of different university campuses as well, which is fantastic. So thank you for taking the time to come out here today. I'm here on behalf of the Monash Student Association to talk about the attacks that we face from both our university administration and the Liberal government. And hence why it's so important that all of you here get behind the Make Education Free Again campaign. Instead, we're forced to shoulder the burden of adjusting to university, of difficulties with our coursework, of our mental illnesses, and of our struggle to balance study and life's obstacles and expenses all by ourselves. When the university prioritizes budget-saving measures ahead of the well-being of its students, we are unable to find a parking spot on campus, let alone one that we don't have to pay for. We're forced to sit in exam rooms at 8 p.m. despite having already completed one at 2 p.m. and despite having another one at 9 a.m. the next day. We have to travel great distances to get to university because all of the regional campuses are severely under-resourced and are facing imminent closure. We have to watch a live stream of our lecture in another room because the lecture theatre itself is far too packed. We have to fork out money from our own pockets to cover the cost of extra course fees, and that's in addition to the ludicrous amount that we pay for textbooks. And yet we are blamed entirely when our grades aren't up to scratch or we're not managing our time appropriately. It's our problem that it's so hard to access resources and even get to university, and we should be doing something about it. Well, that's exactly what we're here today to do. We're here to do something about it. Woo! The Make Education Free Again campaign is relevant to all of us. All of us deserve an equal opportunity to education, and all of them got their degrees for free. Here we stand united and fighting to defend the rights of students to accessible education and welfare, and to demand an end to the tuition fees and enormous debts that will encumber us for decades to come. Thank you very much.
Talk about the stuff that's happened on all different campuses around Australia. Because it's, I think, a very generalised thing that Vice Chancellors all over this country are on the offensive. But first of all, I wanted to do a bit of a name call out. So give me a bit of a cheer if you're, first of all, from Monash. Give me a shout if you're from RMIT. Ray. who is the president of the National Tertiary Education Union, which is the union that represents staff, teachers, academics on our university campuses. I think it's important that she's speaking because we should see the fight of staff for their conditions and the fight of students for ours as one fight. So welcome up Jeannie to the stage.
And it is fantastic to see people here today from universities around Victoria, as because we know that there are students rallying and with staff supporters around in other cities at the moment as well. This is probably not the only time that we will be rallying this year. So let me start by acknowledging that we are meeting on Aboriginal land today, land that was never ceded, and I want to pay my respects to the elders, past and present, and emerging leaders, and also acknowledge any Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders with us today who has made the job harder, sexually harassed and generally been obnoxious. So we are also really proud of you, of NUS, for standing up on the Centrelink outrages, for standing up against the cuts to penalty rates. Because when you do these things, you're standing up for your rights, but you're standing in solidarity with all the other people who often don't have the voice that you have as students, because you do have a voice. It does matter what the students say and think. And of course, that's another reason why we think that the attacks upon universities are not just about money, they're also about what the universities do. What we do in universities, and I know this from when I was an undergraduate to having been an academic for 20 years, is we actually teach people to think. So NUS is doing exactly the right call on fighting on fees to make education free again, but also for calling for decent financial support for students. So good on you, and I'm sure we'll meet again soon. There's a rotten budget coming up. They're going to make the students pay, but we're going to fight them.
That's all. The next speaker that we're going to have up here is going to be Abby Stapleton.
Abby is
the National Women's Officer, so the National Union of Students. For a long time, she's played a really key role in organising campaigns just like this. So she's going to come up and speak to us now. Let's give her a round of applause.
Hello everyone, it's fantastic to be here. Thank you all for coming out today to this contest against cuts to higher education. In particular, it's fantastic to see so many women in the crowd today. Yeah, it's so important that women are at the forefront of this, making our voices heard and protesting against those abhorrent cuts that we've been often. As a result of these cuts, women will likely see an increased pay gap upon graduation, an extended time paying off their head start, and a lower participation rate at university. We don't have a choice. We need to fight back. Student poverty is a real issue in Australia, and it's about time our politicians got their heads out of their asses and did something about it. Yeah! This also means holding universities to account and exposing institutional cover-ups of sexual assault, and recognising that universities and vice chancellors are part of the problem. I hope that all the women here today can get involved in the campaign. It is more important than ever that we continue the fight for a quality, accessible, free higher education system. We owe it to the women who came and fought before us to keep fighting for equality. We owe it to ourselves to demand fair pay and access to health and education. We deserve better than what we're getting. Time and time again, the government tried to introduce funding cuts, and every single time we will come back out and fight.
We're going to have one last speaker and then we're going to march off. We're going to do just what Abby ended on. We're going to fight. We're going to take our voices out into the street and show that we're going to stand up. We're going to shout proud. We're going to fight this government to the end. So our last speaker is the National LGBTI Officer for the National Union of Students, Christy Pasquale. So welcome him up.
Thanks, Jasmine. So, yeah, I'm one of the National LGBTI Officers for the National Union of Students. And I'd like to talk today just briefly about unionism and what kinds of attitudes I think we should bring when we're organising in our unions. Now, 2 weeks ago, I stood a couple of blocks from here with 15,000 construction workers who had walked off the job. These were CFMEU members who'd walked off the job to protest, to march against the Australian Building and Construction Commission and the Fair Work Commission's decision to cut penalty rates. Those workers were told that what they were doing was unlawful activity. John Setka, the secretary of the CFMEU, told us that what they were doing was unlawful. But he also told us that when the justice system doesn't work, you defy it. Bad laws throughout history have been changed by people like yourselves, defying them. They've broken them. Now, last week, on a program called the 7:30 Report, the new ACTU secretary, Sally McManus, was asked by the interviewer Lee Sales if she respected the rule of law. She was told this because she was asked if the ACTU would distance itself from the CFMEU because it had engaged in unlawful activity. To which Sally McManus, to her credit, replied, no, they would not distance themselves from the CFMEU. She said, it might be illegal industrial action, but according to our current laws, but our current laws are wrong. I believe in the rule of law when the law is fair and right, but when it is unjust, I don't think there's a problem with breaking it. Exactly. Yeah, give her a round of applause. Now, Lee Sales found this astounding that someone would express such blatant disregard for the sanctity of laws. Laws, she said, made by our parliament. Yet I would suggest that someone like Lee Sales take a history lesson, because everything that's progressive and good in this society has been won by people who have broken laws. Things that I would imagine Lee Sales would appreciate, things like the right to vote, things like the 8-hour day, things like civil rights. These have been won by people who took illegal action. When Rosa Parks sat on a bus seat in Montgomery, Alabama, she was breaking a law. I wonder if Lee Sales would have the gall to ask Rosa Parks if she respects the sanctity of the rule of law. What she did led to a movement which ended legal segregation in the South. Rosa Parks sitting on that bus seat, that was illegal, but it was the right thing to do. I am not interested in playing by the rules. I'm not interested in going through the so-called appropriate channels. I'm interested in winning. Respecting the rule of law is not some principle that must be upheld. It's a question of tactics. And where laws need to be broken, we break them. This time 3 years ago, we were here in 2014 staring down the barrel of a horror budget by the then Abbott government. We were staring down the barrel of deregulation and the Abbott government potentially fulfilling its lifelong dream of making higher education just the preserve of the rich kids of Australia. Three times that government tried to pass deregulation. Three times it failed. How did they lose? They lost because ordinary students like you, like me, refused to play by the rules. We came out, we chased Liberals off campus, we protested in our thousands, and we made the government's life hell. Now I'm going to wrap up, but before I do, let me say this, that the reason the Liberals are so hell-bent on attacking unions is because they know that that is the way that workers organise to fight for their common interests. It's through organising in unions that workers will be able to beat back the ABCC, be able to beat back measures like cuts to penalty rates. Similarly, it's our student unions, it's in our student unions and our ability to organise in protests, collective protests like this one, where we find our power to be able to beat back, not just to fight against attacks to higher education, but to actually impose our view of what society should look like. And so, I say to you that I want to quote a famous revolutionary, Rosa Luxemburg, who once said, "Those who do not move do not notice their chains." Well, the time to move is now. The time to protest is now. The time to rise is now. Because whether we're fighting trimesters, whether we're fighting homophobia, whether we're fighting for free education, or whether we're fighting for more, we have nothing to lose, but we have a world to win. Thank you.
Well, I think that now
now is the time to take our fight onto the streets. It's through disruption that we have won every single right that we have. And so now we're going to disrupt again. We're going to go out into the streets. So I want everyone to do a bit of a chant with me. We're going to go down to Bourke Street Mall. So will everyone chant with me? No cuts, no fees, no corporate universities, no cuts.
No fees, no corporate universities,
no cuts.
No fees.
I've been here a few times with different protests, and recently I was up here for the protests about Melbourne City Council's idea of making sleeping on the streets a crime, and we had a lot of protests right here, but today's a bit different. I've got Jasmine, who's at Monash University, and what have we been protesting about? It's just about the cuts to education, tertiary education.
We're protesting because we think that university education should be free for everyone. Not even just against all the attacks that Vice Chancellors, that the government levy against students, but for free education.
Yep. Well, I'm studying at Victoria University and I'm doing a Bachelor of Screen Media degree, which is why I run my YouTube channel, and what I'm going to feature this on. So this will be up in a couple of weeks, but I think it's really important that we have really high quality education, and around the world there's different countries that have got free education. Over in the US, many of the degrees cost hundreds of thousands of dollars, which is
big
problem.
Around the world, it's in a pretty efficient state.
Well, that's a big problem. Look, thanks very much for having the chat anyway. And no worries, I'll see you again sometime. Cheers.
Control yourself. Control yourself.
control yourself, you're the life of someone else alive. I'll still be around. Thank you. How you going? Good afternoon. My name's Morf. That was a song I wrote called Slow Down. I'm going to play you a few pieces this afternoon. Hopefully you enjoy them.
Flawed. It's public land set aside for public housing, and that should be the focus. smart public housing development in terms of energy efficiency and in terms of reducing the number of people who are on the public housing, which is stubborn, and producing a development that's in keeping with the local community. I thank you all so much for coming out today in support of your community, in support of public housing and proper planning. Thank you.
I'd now like to ask David Davis to please come and say a few words.
Welcome everyone, my parliamentary colleagues, Kelly O'Dwyer, Graham Watt, Sue Pennicuik, and all of the councillors that are here, the Mayor and Gary Thompson, and to all of you most importantly. I want to, in this context, report that there are two big changes that have happened in the recent period. The first is the passage a week ago of the Development Victoria Bill. That's a new authority designed to develop public land, and the government is on a massive search for public land to do intense high-density development across Melbourne. Now that body has been formed by Places Victoria and the old major projects being coalesced together. But the government has taken an action here, and they've signalled very clearly in the debate and elsewhere, and I pay tribute to Graham's strong advocacy for Markham in the context of that debate, and anyone who hasn't read it, go and read the Development Victoria Bill in both houses and you will see what the government intends. This is the first run of a high density, high rise outcome for Melbourne suburbs. And density, Dan, densification, Dan Andrews, his intention is to pack people in and pack as many as he can into our established suburbs. What he did on the Skyrail, what he's doing and the way he's going around the Metro project, all of those are sham consultation, faux consultation, and a very bad outcome for the community. Good outcomes are achieved where there's proper negotiation. Good outcomes are achieved where there's proper consultation. That's what we want. We want public housing on this site, and we want it at a good density, and we don't want it to compromise the parkland or the local community. I say all power to you today. Congratulate Rita and her committee and the work that they're doing, and they will certainly have our support all the way through. Thank you.
Graham, would you like to come and say a few words? Graham Watt's just going to say a few words now. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Rita. Fantastic crowd. It's good to see that there are so many people here that are so passionate. It's good to see that there are so many people here that are so passionate about this issue. This issue has been running for some time, and the government haven't been listening. I tried to find out information about this project back in September 2015. The government refused to give us information. But what we have found out, as David mentioned, is super profits. This project is all about the government making money and nothing about public housing tenants. I've drawn off the entire area some time ago and I've run petitions, and everybody that I've spoken to has told me exactly what we're hearing today. This development is too large, this development does not fit, and this development does not have enough public housing. I raised in the Parliament the issue around the amount of public housing, and the Planning Minister and the Housing Minister did not even realise that on this development there will be less people accommodated in public housing than there was previously. I do have to say, as disappointed as I was with the result of the Development Victoria Bill, there are other avenues that the Parliament can take. And I keep reminding the Planning Minister of this, there are other avenues. The Upper House, if the Greens come on board, and I'm confident they will, with the Liberals, we can stop this development. But we do need to make sure that every Member of Parliament understands how significant this issue is, and no Member of Parliament should be able to get away without supporting you guys, us, the local community. You need to make sure you keep the pressure up, not only on the Labor Party, but on all members of Parliament, to make sure that this development does not go ahead. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Australia. I'd now like to ask Kelly to come and say a few words. Thank you, Kelly.
Thank you very much, Rita. It is a great pleasure to be with the local community here today. We are all joined together with one voice to say that this Markham estate development is wrong for our local community. It is too high, it is too dense, and for all the reasons that have been explained by the committee, by David Davis, by Graham Watt, and by Gary, and by the Mayor, Philip Healy, we have come together to oppose this inappropriate development. Now, as many of you can see, it's not very far for me to be actually having another baby. And so many people, less than 4 weeks, so many people who live in this beautiful area live here because of its wonderful amenity for so many families. What this development will do is it will create a terrible precedent for this local area with height restrictions that we have never ever seen before. And that is completely wrong for the local community, and it is completely wrong for the amenity of the local community. So I join with you and my colleagues in saying that I have received thousands of emails and letters from all of you saying we must join together, no matter what political party we are, to come together to speak with one voice, and we are there with you, we will fight with you, and we will back the local council to make sure it's not built in the current form in which the Andrews government wants to build it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Kelly, and thank you to all our speakers. The importance now just going to wind us up.
Okay, everyone, the answer to these questions is yes. We want to show this government that we're responsible and that we are going to help them to get this to be designed as a proper development. So I just want the answer yes. Do we want fairness for public housing?
Yes!
Come on, do we want fairness for public housing?
Yes!
Do we want planning returned back to council?
Yes!
Do we want this development to comply with the gazetted policies and planning guidelines?
Yes!
This is going to be 21 metres high, not 11 metres high, twice the standard. Do we want that? No!
We'll go. So today I'm actually out at Ashburton. I don't normally come out this way. I cover a lot of things in the city and I live in Reservoir. But I'm always looking at new things to cover, and today's been an important thing, and I've got Sue Pennicuik from the Greens. And it's been a good turnout here today. I couldn't believe it. I mean, I thought maybe they'd get 10 people. But
yeah, great turnout from the local community. Yeah, very concerned about this issue.
Yeah, exactly. Look, public housing is an absolute critical importance to society. And as people have mentioned, there's about 30-odd thousand people on the public waiting list. And we need more development, but it's got to be done right. And obviously this has been planned not correctly by the sound of it. It's super high density and super high. So what would you prefer to see? Instead of what's proposed, what do you think they should actually do?
I think they should, I think they should focus on public housing on the Markham estate site.
Yep.
Everybody agreed that the existing public housing units there needed to be basically demolished and rebuilt.
Yep.
And that's what everyone expected was going to happen.
Yep.
Instead, we've got a proposal to sell off 170, to put where there were 56 units,
yep,
and put 250 units. It's a relatively small site,
yep,
on the banks of the Gardeners Creek, so it has a lot of environmental impacts. It will have a lot of environmental impacts if those.
Yep, that's a big jump from 50-odd to 250.
Yes, it's a massive densification on the site. We're going to lose some remnant native vegetation, some very old native trees that are on the site will be gone, and those that are remaining will be under a lot of stress because of the densification. But it's also completely inappropriate for the area that it's in.
Yep. And the thing is too, I mean, you've got people that need this housing, but you don't need to cram them in like bloody sardines. We need to be smarter about it. And that's why I like covering these things, and I've been at a lot of the affordable housing rallies in the city. It's good to see the Defend and Extend public housing group were represented here today, because they have a monthly thing at the Parliament that I've been covering, and that's been interesting. And also the other thing that I'm a little bit different to this, but one of the things I've been covering a lot recently is Melbourne City Council's attempts to put through a bylaw to make rough sleeping on the streets illegal, and talking about fining people $388, which I think is just ridiculous. That's created a lot of vocal, upheaval. And maybe instead of these sorts of developments, maybe they should have a real think about, doing things appropriately. So I think there's two examples where they've basically gone off the rails.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. That's caused a lot of concern in the community about making being homeless illegal. How can that be right? Yeah. And we do have, you know, a growing number of homeless people, as you said, 30,000 or more on the public housing waiting list. And this is an opportunity to use that site, which has been set aside by previous governments for public housing in recognition that we need more public housing. And in fact, we're going to get less public housing on that site, and the rest of it sold off to private development, public land. And that's a concept that I fundamentally disagree with. I think that the site should be, it should be a benchmark for energy efficient, socially, you know, sensitive, environmentally sensitive,
and not cram people in
housing, and make it a site that could be the benchmark for others around us.
Well, look, I think today's been a great turnout, and I'm sure there'll be other events and things like that.
It's great because the local community aren't saying we don't want public housing; they're saying we do want public housing, and we don't want this great private monolith.
Exactly.
Plopped in the middle of our community.
Look, thanks very much for having the chat.
Thanks.
That's all right. That's all right. I'll give you one of my. I wouldn't have, no, that's Graham's card. That won't work. How about I give you one of mine? Oh, here we go. I'll stop this. Before I wrap up this episode, which will be the last for a few weeks, the other night I was down in the city and a fairly new entity on the block, Freedom from Poverty, and they're having a little bit of a protest down there at Federation Square and had a few signs out and things like that. And here's a quick interview I did with Dave, who's from Sydney, and they're planning a fairly big operation up in Canberra for somewhere around the middle of June. So here's that. All right, so down here at Federation Square, it's, nearly 9 o'clock on Good Friday, and stumbled across some people here that have got a bit of a protest going regarding homelessness. I've got Dave from Freedom for Poverty. Thanks very much for having a chat.
No worries.
So what exactly are you hoping to achieve out of tonight's action, and sort of, is it just you're going to be here for a couple of hours, or what's your plan?
Look, we're staying from sunset to sunrise because we thought, you know, Good Friday, and this is an issue where we got to start doing some good.
Yep.
So, I mean, we're taking a stand against poverty. And soon we're going to be putting an ask to all federal, state and territory politicians to start doing something about it.
Yep.
So coming up to June 23rd this year, it's going to be 30 years since Bob Bourke's promise. By 1990, no Australian child will be living in poverty.
Yeah, we've seen how that went.
Well, so it turns out that 1.1 million people born since 1990 live in poverty today.
Yes.
So basically, we're going to be calling on them to, you know, let's work together, get them working together, and let's do something about it. Like, let's come up with a plan to end it. You know, targets around 15%, 20%, it's not enough. You've got to aim to end it, and anything less means you're abandoning people before you even start.
And we're pretty smart, and you know, humans, we can achieve a lot, and we can do some crazy stuff with technology and stuff like that, and yet we don't seem to be able to get some of the fundamentals sorted, and this is ridiculous.
I mean, you often hear homelessness is a complex issue, which it is, for sure, and a lot of the issues relating to it are complex, but fixing the actual problem of homelessness is just a matter of homes.
Yeah.
It's homes and homelessness. It's as simple as that. And I'm just kind of sick of the lack of action. I mean, it's not enough investment, not enough work being done. We're calling for something to actually start happening.
That's fair enough. And I mean, the thing is that we've got too many people that are living in poverty. We've got too many people that are homeless. Too many people who have just got their lives are just not what they could be. And the thing I always say to people is, you know, I spent 5.5 years living in a van. I was homeless for that time. And in the last 3 years, I've been able to do some amazing things. And that just shows that if you get people housed and you let them sort of get their life balanced a bit, they can go on to achieve amazing things. And that's the big message. And the longer we hold people down and just keep them down and every cent's tied up in paying rent and then they don't have any disposable income, which is basically what it means when you're below the poverty line, that just wrecks lives, and we need to get it fixed. So,
if you can't meet your basic needs, it's hard to build a better life. It's hard to get involved in your community, to contribute, to do what you love.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you've picked a good spot tonight here at Fed Square. We've got the comedy festival going on, and this is no laughing matter. So hopefully you get some public support. And look, thanks very much for having the chat.
Thank you, appreciate
Cheers,
it.
Man. No worries. As I mentioned, this is going to be the last episode for a few weeks. For a couple of reasons, need to sort of give weekly catch-up out and about with Trev a break for a little while. I've got some big projects that I'm working on. I've got my big doco that I've been working on for the last 12 months, and it's time to finalise that and screen it and let the investors and the crew see what we've worked on. And that's going to be around the 24th of May. And also at that time, I'm planning on launching my crowdfunding for my next project, which is a totally different project. It's a short film. It's going to be for assessment in one of my final classes in my last year at uni. I'm studying a Bachelor of Screen Media degree, as I've mentioned a few times. And it's going to be a really exciting project. I'm going to have a bit different crew. I've got a girl that's keen to be on board as an art director and help me sort out sets and props and things like that. And also dealing with some actors or some people that have got some acting experience anyway. So that's going to be an exciting project. We're hoping to film towards the end of July, and the whole thing's got to be finished by the end of September. So that'll be pretty cool. I'm pretty sure we'll be filming over the very last week of July. So we'll probably bring a on-location special episode of Weekly Catch-Up out and about with Trev as we're off filming that thing, which would be pretty cool because some of the spots, some of the locations I'm looking at filming in are quite interesting. We have some night shots and things like that. It's going to be great. So with those two big things that I'm working on, I thought it was good to have a bit of a break. I've got quite a bit going on. There's only so many hours in the week. But I did think it was important to tie up a few loose ends. So primarily, Defend and Extend Public Housing have got their ongoing campaign running on the front steps of Parliament House every month, and the dates are listed below for their upcoming operations. Freedom from Poverty are planning their thing and up in Canberra in June. So on the 30th anniversary of Bob Hawke's famous speech about, you know, No Child Living in Poverty by 1990, and we certainly know that didn't go to plan. And we also wait now that public submission has closed on Melbourne City Council's plans to basically ban the homeless. We wait to see what they're going to do. You would hope that, you know, they'd see reason and listen to the community, but you never know. And so that's basically it. I've really enjoyed putting these episodes together, and I think there's been some really cool issues, some cool episodes. Stuff like the zombie walk was fun, but some of the more important things like the affordable housing, the stuff like homelessness, Bendigo Street remains, there's an episode there on Bendigo Street, remains my most popular episode so far, and that was cool because they just had a recent court win and they're out in the street, had bands and things like that, and that was just a great day, and the weather was perfect as well. I'd like to thank everyone that's allowed me to interview them and have a chat. Obviously we've got recent stuff with David Atkins from The White Knight and people like that, but even just some of the guys and girls that are doing it very tough on the street, and some of the ones that have spoken at some of the speeches. The fact they've been able to get up and put forward their heartfelt message from, you know, that what they've experienced is really cool, and to get some of that on video is great. I'd also like to thank all the buskers and musicians that have allowed me to use their music, and I've got a whole swathe of a big database of stuff now. It's great, and I really appreciate that. And yeah, so I'll be back on the 29th. Should be a couple of days after we've screened the doco, and hopefully we'll maybe do a bit of an episode about how that went. But until then, we're gonna have a break. I will say though that if anything important comes up and there's any important events and things like that, I'll still be out and about with the camera. I can still head out and film stuff, and then we can roll it into future episodes. So anyway, guys, thanks for watching. Cheers.